Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I'll talk about divergence and crashing programs. A better way of dealing with crashing is exception handling, and I'll say something about continuations. So let's get started. So first of all, let's consider working towards understanding what divergence is. The following division algorithm. It is presented as a procedure that is of a function type. It takes three input parameters, x, y, and z. You can understand it as follows. Z is an accumulator that starts at zero whenever you want to divide x by y. And the outcome is the result of that division. So in the case that x is smaller than y, we immediately return the accumulator z. And otherwise, when x is bigger than or equal to y, we subtract y from x and then recursively call our function d, increasing the accumulator by 1. And so this division algorithm is implemented by repeated subtraction. So then you can ask yourself, okay, suppose I give as arguments 7, 2, and as accumulator 0. So what is the result of 7 divided by 2? Well, for that you can then understand the execution of this program by considering the procedure invocation stack. This is also called the call stack. For each procedure that is recursively called, we record what are the arguments to the procedure. In this case we have d, and its arguments initially are 7, 2, and 0. So that is what we start with on the call stack. Now, if you inspect the body of what is declared here, you see that 7 is bigger than 2. So we go into the else branch and we recurse. So in that case, we then nested within the call d, within the call to d with the arguments 7 and 2, we perform another call to d with the arguments 5 and 2, but this time the accumulator is increased by 1. And again, 5 is bigger than 2, so we can again go in the else branch and perform another recursive call, so we get 3, 2, and the accumulator now is 2. Again, we go into the else branch and we go to 1, 2, 3. So x is 1, y is 2, and z is 3 at this point. And at this point, you also see that 1 is smaller than 2. So what then is specified is that we should return the accumulator, that is 3. So in this case, we return 3 and we jump back to the previous call site, which is over here. So the value of this function call is now whatever was returned by the deeper call. That's 3. So that's also immediately returned. And so forth, all the way back up. And so the outcome of calling d with the argument 7, 2, 0, then must be 3. Okay, so this makes a lot of sense. This is the way you usually expect functions to return. However, what happens whenever we supply to the same procedure the following arguments, 7, 0, and as accumulator, 0. So what is the result of 7 divided by 0? Well, in the case of repeated subtraction, what do you expect? It is the case that 7 is not smaller than 0. So whenever we invoke 7, 0, 0, whenever we consider, hey, what is the case? It is not the case that 7 is smaller than 0. So we must go into the else branch. But in the else branch, since y here is 0, the subtraction does not decrease x. So the only thing that we do is increase the accumulator. And this goes on and on and on and on. And the depth of the call stack increases and increases. And so this goes on forever. Now, of course, depending on your implementation, you will at some point hit a limit on the depth of the call stack, or as is also called a stack overflow. But mathematically speaking, whenever there is not a bound a priori on the depth of the stack, this can continue indefinitely. And whenever you have such an algorithm, whenever it is computing and continues indefinitely, we can say that then this computation then diverges. it does not lead us to a result. Okay, so this divergence can happen. I mean, you can give definitions, you can give recursive function definitions, whatever you want. And sometimes it may occur that for given arguments, you have this divergence. But as a user of the computer, you actually don't know whether it is diverging or doing some useful work. Maybe the work it is performing takes a little bit longer than what you expected. So is there maybe an effective method for checking that a procedure does not diverge for any of its arguments? And as it turns out, that this checking of whether a procedure does not diverge for any of its arguments, itself is an undecidable problem. So such an effective method does not exist. But we do have to deal with these potentially diverging situations. So it is not possible to give an effective method, but we do seem to encounter these situations whenever we naively present our algorithms in such a way. So is there maybe a pragmatic way out of this? Well, there is, because we have already seen in the previous case that this divergence certainly happens whenever our second argument, the thing that we divide by, is zero. It is not allowed to divide by zero. So what we could then do is we could crash. And crashing basically means that the programmer signals that the program is not intended to give a result in this case, but also the programmer knows that it is wasteful for the user to wait for a result to appear. So a crash signals to the user that the program cannot compute a correct outcome. So crashing you can understand as a very crude way of stopping the overall execution. So the overall execution of the program is stopped. It's immediately saying, I give up. And you lose, whenever you crash, potentially interesting results that you have accumulated in between. So this crashing, it's kind of a crude way. Maybe in some programs, for instance, where a lot of useful computations have been completed, then some crash occurs, and then you lose all this data that you have computed before. So is there not a better way to deal than crashing? Well, for that, there are exceptions and exception handling. And you could think of exceptions as more fine-grained ways of stopping only parts of the execution. So to isolate the error that you encounter to only part of the program, and that you can gracefully recover from such an error and thereby not lose useful data that you might have computed before encountering the crash. So now think about this. How do we usually deal with, for instance, division by zero? I mean, most computers allow you to perform integer division, and so then it is also potentially possible that you divide by zero. What does a computer then do? And for instance, your pocket calculator might give you simply an error on the screen, but whenever you perform integer division during a program, try to understand what will happen. And in different programming languages, there are different ways of dealing with it. And now the graceful way of dealing with it is by raising an exception. So let's first consider the crude way of dealing with this division by zero issue. And so we could, for instance, say, if we take our division algorithm from before, that we now additionally perform a check. We check before we even consider x and y in relation to each other, whether y is zero at the start. And if it turns out that y is zero, then we can immediately crash. So whenever we, for instance, want to divide 5 by zero, then we would invoke this procedure over here, x is 5, y is 0, z is 0. Well, and then this this test for whether y is 0 is true, so then we encounter a crash command. And the crash entirely tears down the execution. So this causes the program to crash entirely. Now, that the fact that we have crashing behavior does not mean that this program always crashes. So for certain input arguments that we could supply, The program does complete, does terminate normally, and it gives you back a correct result. And now also, having a program which sometimes crashes and sometimes still gives you back the correct answer does not mean that the program is free from divergences. And to give you a concrete example, consider that we call this D with the arguments 1, minus 1, 0. Maybe this algorithm was not designed for negative numbers in the first place. Because consider whenever we call 1 minus 1, 0, so we want to divide 1 by minus 1, then in the naive way we consider, well, y is certainly not 0, so we do not crash. So we can continue with this part over here. And is it the case that 1 is smaller than minus 1? No, it is not. So we are in the else branch and we must recurse. And then we do x minus minus 1, which results in 2 minus 1 and increasing the accumulator by 1. And this goes on and on and on. So we go to 3 minus 1, 2, etc., etc., etc. So this is an example where we both have crashing behavior, where, for instance, the second argument is 0, then we immediately crash. We have a normal behavior because in the positive cases, whenever x and y are positive, it gives you back the correct answer. But we also have divergences. If the second argument, for instance, is negative, we will not make much progress. Okay, so then this allows you to then summarize what are the potential outcomes of calling procedures. And in this case, our procedure has a function type, so we expect it to return some value. But what are the potential outcomes? So whenever you perform a call within some given state and you have given input arguments, well, then it is either the case that the procedure has normal behavior. And by that I mean that the procedure just terminates. And if it's in function, just like our division algorithm before, then it also returns back a value. So that's all fine. Then it is also possible, and we have also seen this before, that the procedure call has diverging behavior. And that means that the procedure does not terminate, but it is always seemingly busy with performing computations. It is somehow stuck, maybe in forever trying to call itself or in some kind of loop. And then there is no value to return. Now, the third possibility is that you have a crashing behavior. And so, it is the case that the procedure terminates, but it terminates abruptly, and in the case of a function, there is no return value. And now, in this crashing behavior, it's a crude form of error handling, the whole program crashes. So, you cannot escape from it. Now the main question is, we understand these three possible outcomes of performing a procedure call, but is there a way that this crashing can be isolated so that this crashing does not tear down the entire execution of the program? Well, and for that we introduce exceptions. And let's look at them. So exceptions are a mechanism for handling abnormal returns from a procedure. So on the one hand, we have the normal returns. And in the case of a function, you expect some kind of value to be returned. But you also have the void return type. And in that case, nothing in particular is returned, but the procedure terminates. And then we have the abnormal return. So it is the case that the procedure terminates. Because the execution, it is no longer possible to continue with the execution. But it signals that something strange has happened. And what is that thing that has happened? Well, that thing that has happened is what is called an exception. And the exceptions can be specified in the program by using new programming constructs. So one programming construct is to throw an exception. And so instead of returning an expression, you can now throw an expression. And that means that the value of that expression is returned abnormally. And that the return value then is the exception. That is raised, as it is called. The procedure then raises an exception. Now, whenever there are exceptions raised, and it still now behaves like a crash. But is there a way to detect whether during the execution of some command an exception has occurred? Well, and to do that checking, there is the programming construct for trying out the execution of one part of the program. That is whatever is stated here. This is just some command that you try out. And now if that command completes normally, so it does not raise any exception in the meantime, well, then it's fine. And then this whole try catch business is also terminated. But in the case that S, the execution of this part of the program, raises an exception, then the catch part of this command will be invoked. And the value that was thrown up is now catched and bound to this variable. And in this case, there is no type declaration, but some languages require you to additionally put a type there. And then this part of the program, which is called the exception handler, is invoked to handle the exception. So to understand this better, it may be a good idea to introduce an example. Now, by the way, before introducing the example, I should say that whenever you have, for instance, recursive procedure calls, and you do not have a try-catch in between of these calls, it is the case that an exception bubbles up all the way the call stack, as it is called. So that means that whenever deeply down in a call stack some exception occurs, while there are no exception handlers underway, it keeps peeling off all the calls in the call stack until it counters at some point a context in which a try-catch occurs. And then at that place, it is the nearest place within the context that then the exception is caught and then handled. So now let me show you the example. Oh yeah, by the way, if you forget to use any try catch, so then the exception boils up all the way, bubbles up all the way to the top, and there is no catch exception handler that is encountered in the way, well then it behaves as if you have crashed the program. So here is an example. So this example might require a little bit of explanation. First of all, we have the procedure P, and P has no particular value that it wants to return. It has the void return type. So what are the possible behaviors of P? Well, that depends on the argument X, so the value of the input parameter. Now, if X is negative, then P abnormally returns, and it throws the exceptional value minus 1. Now, if it turns out that X is positive, then the procedure P abnormally returns with the exceptional value 1. And if neither X is negative nor it is positive, so if X is 0, then P normally returns. And it normally returns, but it does not have a particular value to return because it is declared to have a return type void. Okay, so that is then the behavior of P, or at least that's how you can understand the behavior of P. Now, within the context of the procedure Q, let's see what happens. If it turns out, we have two input parameters, X and Y, and we analyze what is the sign, as it is called, of X. If X is equal to 0, then we invoke or call procedure P with the second argument. If it is the case that X is negative, so X is smaller than 0, then we recursively invoke our procedure Q again by increasing both X and Y. But if X is positive, we recursively invoke Q by decreasing both of its arguments. Now, what do you think that this procedure Q is doing? Suppose we supply it as arguments 2 and 2. In the case of 2, X is positive. So it recurses Q 1, 1. And then again, 1, X, is positive, so it recurses again 0, 0. Since X now is 0, we look at P, which we invoke with the argument 0. And considering P, P returns normally whenever its argument is 0. So P here returns normally, so that means that Q returns normally, and all the way up it all returns normally, and then we have a normal return of Q. However, whenever the arguments are not equal, something else happens. Namely, the procedure does not normally return. It has an abnormal return value, namely some exceptional value. In the context of the procedure QQ, you can see what happens whenever such an exceptional return value occurs. So consider that we supply x and y as arguments to the nested call Q. In the case that Q returns normally, then we can proceed as a sequential composition and QQ can return with the value 0. But in the case that Q returns abnormally, then the exceptional value that was then thrown is catched over here and bound by this variable z. And in that case, the exception handler returns from the procedure QQ with the minus of whatever the exceptional value was. And so in this case, the exceptional value is an integer. So let's consider an example. So to consider the example, consider the following call stack that is generated whenever you call QQ with the arguments 5 and 3. And so 5 is positive, so QQ first calls within the try-catch block the procedure Q. And Q then recursively calls itself, decreasing both of its arguments. Again, decreasing its both of its arguments. Again, decreasing both of its arguments. Because it is looking at the first argument, this keeps on going until the first argument is 0. And then we invoke P, but with the second argument. So in that case, we invoke P minus 2. However, P analyzes whether the argument is positive or negative, and in that case throws an exception. In this case, P is negative, so it throws minus 1. Now, what does this throw do? It looks within the immediate context and it cannot find any try-catch construct. So then the exceptional value bubbles up all the way through the call stack. But in the case of Q, there is also not a try-catch surrounding the call. And so that the exceptional value bubbles the way up all the way the call stack until at some point we encounter within QQ the exception handler. And in that case, the exception handler reverses the sign of the exceptional value, and that is then returned. So the funny thing here is that the procedure QQ, it returns normally with the value 1, while internally some exception has happened. But it could recover from this error, and the recovery of this error resulted in a normal completion of the procedure call QQ. So this tries to explain to you at least the important notion of unwinding what is called unwinding the call stack. And so while looking for an exception handler, the call stack is piece by piece unwound until the nearest exception handler within the context of the call is encountered. And then the handler associated there is invoked. Okay, so those are exceptions. Now, an interesting addition to exceptions. Exceptions are typically implemented in many languages. For example, Java, C++ also has exceptions. Many other programming languages have exceptions, and they all generally deal with it in the same manner as explained here. However, a more advanced concept that is very similar to exceptions are continuations. Namely, the following question can be asked. As soon as you have thrown an exception, is it then possible, and you have unwound the call stack, and you have encountered an exception handler, is it then possible, for instance, that you have repaired an issue, if you have maybe made sure that the error, that the cause of the error is gone now, is it now possible to go back all the way in the call stack and resume at the point after where the exception was thrown? Is it possible to resume the execution after the throwing, the exception that was thrown resulted in some kind of solution to an issue that was detected? Well, for that, you could consider continuations. So you can understand that as follows. So suppose that an exception is raised at some point while executing a program. Now, it is just like before, whenever an exception is raised, the call stack is unwound. But now in this case, we don't unwind the call stack. We leave the call stack in place. We only search the call stack. until some kind of handler, hè, de exception handler, is found within the context of the call stack. So now the handler is invoked and the handler can maybe repair the issue at hand. And then the handler is supplied additionally what is called a continuation. And the continuation represents the deeper in the call stack, the context where the execution encountered the exception. And so that whenever you then activate the continuation, you basically continue the execution after the throw command. So it's basically that you then jump back in the program at the point where the exception was originally raised. And in this case then control point is restored and the execution of the program can resume. It's a quite a nice feature if you are able then to repair certain problems that you can detect only whenever you, for instance, are deeply executing some kind of algorithm. So alternatively, what if the handler cannot repair or solve the issue in any way? Well, then you can simply not activate the continuation. And then if since the continuation is no longer activated, it is as if this whole call stack has been unwound and then thrown away. So it is, these continuations are well not very common in language implementations, programming languages implementations. Java, C++, C#, they all do not support continuations in this way. But other languages such as Common Lisp, for instance, do support continuations. Continuations are very common in processor hardware. And so whenever you are on the very low level, your processor, for instance, also has an arithmetic unit. And the arithmetic unit can perform, for instance, division, and therefore it can raise errors. What are typically called at this level not errors or exceptions. No, at the hardware level, these are typically called interrupts. And now a processor can cause an interrupt, either internally because of a programming mistake, or an interrupt can be encountered because some external device causes the interruption of the execution of the program. In that case, the processor does not walk the call stack. No, instead it has some kind of fixed number of interrupt handlers that can be put in place. So in the case of invoking the interrupt handler, certainly you want to, maybe in the case of, for instance, an external interrupt, you want to resume executing the program where you left off. And so this is the place where you most typically encounter these kinds of continuations. Okay, so to give you a number of examples where continuations would be useful, consider for instance division by zero. Well, this is clearly an exception that is raised. It is not very much likely to be resumable. It signals a programming error. And the fact that the program specifies a division by zero indicates a programming error. So you won't likely want to resume from such an exception. But another example of an exception would be, for instance, whenever you want to allocate new objects and thereby you want to require some free memory space, but then it turns out that there is no free memory space. And so then you, in that case, can generate an exception that you are out of memory. But such an exception can potentially be handled by, for instance, plugging in extra memory into your device or maybe cleaning up other parts of the memory. And then after that operation, you want to resume. The resumption after that exception likely leads to then a successful allocation of the memory. Another example of an exception would be, for instance, a program that performs input and output. And suppose in the old days that you had, for instance, optical devices, suppose you have a program that reads some file from an optical device, and then it encounters a read error. Well, the program then is stuck at that point, and it raises an exception. But what you can now try to do is let the program be stuck at this position. You could remove the optical disk, maybe you remove some of its dust particles, and then reinsert it in the machine and try again. And now, in that case, it is makes a lot of sense for the exception to be resumable, eh? To after you have performed as a user some kind of operation to solve the issue, that you then want to retry the operation and then resume the program's execution. However, in some cases, an input-output error is simply not recoverable. For instance, if your device is malfunctioning and you cannot seem to solve such an issue. Well, there is maybe another example of an exception which is presumably resumable, namely a timeout. So consider, for instance, that you run a program and you give it a fixed amount of time in which it is allowed to run. Because suppose you have in your mind, you give it a maximum of 30 minutes. And why do you need to add timeouts? Well, for instance, this detection of whether a program is diverging or not, in general, is undecidable. So how can you now be pragmatic about this? Well, you just give an upper limit in time of how much you expect the computation to, in time-wise, need, of how much time it needs to compute. And if it takes longer, then maybe there's something wrong goes on. Maybe it's stuck in some loop, or maybe the computation took too much time that you did not expect. In that case, it is very useful to raise a timeout. And in that case, the timeout is not resumable if the deadline has been reached. So your 30 minutes has been reached, and then you don't want to give it more time. But alternatively, instead of having it not resumable, you could also consider timeout to be resumable. And maybe you inspect the program state and you think, well, it's actually quite hopeful if we continue its execution. You can extend the deadline and then the exception is resumable. This is just for you to give it. This is just for you to have an impression of what are typical exceptions that you could encounter, and whether you want or not to resume such exceptions. So that is in the case where you encounter them within your program, whether you want the program at that point to be resumable or not. Now, as I mentioned, for instance, languages like Java, C++, C#, do not have a built-in notion of resumable exceptions. So to implement these kinds of resumable exceptions, you have to do a lot of convoluted stuff. You have to, for instance, do checking of whether an operation succeeded or not, and you cannot make use of the exception handling mechanism to do that. So it is certainly also possible to implement something similar to this using, for instance, return values. You can signal whether a particular operation was successful or not, and then let the program decide at that point what to do, whether to retry something or not. So it is certainly conceivable, if your programming language does not support exceptions or resumable exceptions, that you can work around this problem by, for instance, explicitly encoding it yourself within the program. As an example of a continuation, consider the following. Now, here you have a global variable, say z, with an initial value -5 and a procedure p and a procedure q. Now, what does the procedure P do? Well, normally it just prints the value of Z, but in the case that Z is 0 or negative, it raises an exceptional value, in this case 1. So now in the case of Q, we see that we have this try block over here. So that means that Q tries to execute P, but in the case P does not normally complete, it does not return normally, but it returns abnormally with an exceptional value. In that case, we have a special exception handler. And this is a way to understand how continuations can be used. Instead of just having the value that was raised, the exceptional value that was raised, that we then handle, now you can think of the C to be a special kind of procedure variable that we can then invoke as if it was a procedure. And that stands for the continuation. So let's consider. Initially, our value z is -5. So whenever we invoke q and then we invoke p, then we are in this context over here. We check whether z is indeed smaller than or equal to 0. And -5 is smaller than 0. So this causes the exception to be raised. So then we unwind, or at least we search first, the call stack. And then we see that the immediate catching, so the immediate exception handler that we can find, is over here. What do we then do? We consider the control point after the throw statement. to be part of the continuation, right? So the entire call stack and all the state of the local variables up to that point are all stored somehow implicitly in this continuation C. And the exceptional value 1 is now assigned to E. And we then execute the exception handler. In this case, in the exception handler, we check whether the exceptional value is indeed 1. Well, it is, because E here, the value that was thrown is 1. 1 is equal to 1. We can continue with changing the global variable to 5. This is repairing the issue at hand. And then after the issue has been repaired, our Z value now becomes positive, we can then perform the continuation. So in this case, this call to C causes control point to jump back after the throw command. And then indeed, it prints the value Z, which is now 5 successfully. And it completes P normally. And then we are over here. We have completed P normally. So this whole try catch is also completed normally. And Q is completed normally. So if you have these continuations, a natural question to ask, Is it now possible, because we have this C, to resume more than once? Well, yes, it is certainly possible to resume more than once. Consider, for example, this program. Again, we have the global variable Z, and now again we have procedure P, which whenever Z is not positive, it will throw an exceptional value. Now, in the case that we perform Q, we have now in the try block, two commands. We first call P, and then after that one has returned normally, we again call P. So what happens now? We suppose that we call Q. In that case, we try out the first call to P, and since Z has the value minus 5, we throw an exceptional value, 1. So in that case, we consider this point here, the control point over here, to be the continuation in C. An exceptional value E is over here. We call the exception handler and we first assign Z to be 5. So now that we have repaired the error by changing the global variable to be 5 and we perform the continuation. In this case, the continuation jumps back to the control point we had over here and we print Z. Z is now recovered and it is now 5. And we return from P normally. Since we return normally, we encounter the control point over here and we call P again. Since Z still has the value 5, we can still print it. Okay, now we reach the end of P and we return normally. And now we reach the end of the try block. Now this is a signal that we have finished the continuation. So what then happens is that we now jump to the continuation over here has finished and we can jump to the control point over here. And now, in the handler, in the exception handler, we can perform the assignment of Z to be 6. So, and we can continue the continuation again. What happens? We change the global variable Z to 6, and the continuation represented the old point where our exceptional value was thrown. So we jump back to this position over here, and then we perform a print of Z. Z now has the value 6. Where are we if you then consider the continuation to be a snapshot of the call stack? And in that position, we were in this call where the error occurred for the first time. So whenever we return from P normally, we now are at this control point between the two calls of P. So that means that P is then executed another time, but this time we pass the if because Z is still 6 and we print 6. Now we reach the end of the try block, so that means we can then continue over here. We reach the end of the catch block, so that means we reach the end of the try catch block. Okay, of the try catch command. And then we reach the end of Q. So that shows to you, these continuations are quite complicated beasts because they allow you, whenever you have one call to a procedure, to have potentially multiple times that it is returned from if there occurs some kind of resumable exception, which is then resumed more than once. Okay, so that was this video about exceptions, exception handling, crashing, divergence, and the advanced concept of continuations. Thank you for watching and see you later.